Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Netflix Flink Meetup. My name is Mark Cho, and I'm an engineer on the Flink platform team at Netflix, and I'm the MC for the meetup today. We're going to start with our first two talks, and then we'll take a five-minute break before the third talk. And after the third talk, we're going to be using the breakout rooms in Zoom. And you'll have an opportunity to ask questions and interact with the speakers in these breakout rooms. So if you have any questions during the presentations, please add your question to the Slido. When you're adding the questions, please label your questions so that the question goes to the right speaker. We're also recording the meetup today, and the recording will be shared after the meetup. All right, let's dive into our first presentation. For the first talk, we have Marta from Ververica, and she'll be presenting building an end-to-end analytics pipeline with PyFlink.
Okay, hello everyone. Thanks a lot, Mark, for the introduction and Netflix for hosting this meetup and being really active member or part of the Flink community. And hi to everyone on the other side. I really appreciate that you made it to the meetup on such a big day in the US. And like Mark said, I work as a developer advocate. And so I've been involved in the Flink community for around 2 years now. I work in the company that employs most of the maintainers of Flink. And if there's one thing that being at home really amplified for me, because I was so used to being very close every day to the community, it really is like how hard it is sometimes to keep up with the pace of the project. So what I wanted to give you today was an overview of how PyFlink has evolved over time, where it stands today after the 1.12 release, and also give you some place to start with a simple demo for an analytics pipeline if you've never heard about PyFlink before or you just need a place to get started. Oops, just from my slides, give me a second. Okay, so first things first, the first question that backs this whole story up is why adding a Python API to Flink at all? Well, Flink is JVM based, and there's a very high chance that if you're using it, you're either coding in Java or Scala, or you're building infrastructure for other people to be able to use it without Java or Scala. So this was definitely on the top of the list, just to expose the functionality of Flink to Python users and beyond the JVM. And on the opposite side, there's also an interest in bringing the Python ecosystem closer to Flink, because Python has a very mature analytics stack with very popular libraries like NumPy and Pandas or scikit-learn. They are really fast and intuitive, especially for numeric computations. And also a lot of the newer libraries that are released around machine learning, natural language processing, and this kind of domains are also either written in or built first for Python. So there's a huge ecosystem out there, especially for folks doing data science. But also if you look at these popular libraries that we are all using these days in 2021, a lot of them have been around for over 10 years. And even Python itself is older than Java. So one of the problems with these older libraries that you still want to use very frequently, like Pandas, is that they're mostly restricted to the resources of whatever machine you're running Python on. So if you want to parallelize and really scale out, it's also useful to be able to distribute and scale the functionality of Python through Flink.
Hey, Marta. Just one sec. We're not seeing the updated screen being shared. I think you're on a couple of slides and we're still on the intro slide. Is it being updated on your side?
Yeah.
Give me a Maybe second. Restart the... Oh, there we go.
Okay.
All right.
Is this passing slides now?
We're on the Y Flink plus Python slide.
Okay, and can you see the new next slide if I do this? Like the PyFlink over time slide?
No.
No.
Okay, then let me just, I think I have a problem here.
Can you stop sharing and then reshare maybe?
Can you see it like this?
Yeah, I think this is good. Yeah, we're seeing it.
Cool, thanks a lot for letting me know, Mark. And sorry you didn't see the slides. So I'll just restart from here. So I was starting with the whole motivation to have Python support in Flink. So basically, just exposing the functionality of Flink to Python users, and then kind of dealing with these older libraries that don't really scale and distributing them through Flink. So where did the community start actually implementing or baking Python support into Flink? So if you think about it, PyFlink is actually quite young. So if you think about other projects out there that are kind of in the same line, PyFlink has only been around for roughly a year and a half. And in the first phase, when the beta was released in 1.9, if I remember correctly still, it was a very bare bones wrapper around the table API that allowed you to do stateless operations only. And in the next iteration, then the community added support for UDFs, which was a pretty big deal, because then this meant that you could start baking your own logic into standard table API programs. And 1.10 also meant that you no longer had to build PyFlink from source to use it yourself. You could just install it from PyPy like any other Python package. And then moving forward from 1.11, PyFlink really started getting traction. There started having more and more contributors working on it every release. And in 1.10, it was the release where the integration with Pandas was materialized. And through Pandas, like then also the integration with all these libraries that I was telling you about before. So PyFlink also became available outside of PyFlink itself, if I can say like that. So even if you're a SQL user or you're a user of the Java table API, you can also take advantage of PyFlink, write own Python UDFs and embed them in your Java applications, for example. And in the last release, I think the biggest breakthrough, and this is where we're at now with Flink 1.12, is that there's also now initial support for the data stream API. So in a pretty short time, PyFlink has come a really long way. And one of the things that I wanted to do to get myself familiar with PyFlink as well was to try to solve an actual problem I had at work, which is roughly not being a robot and it being very difficult to get the gist or an idea of what happens in the Flink user mailing list, which is where Flink users go to maintainers to get their issues with Flink solved, or to get their questions answered. So things like, what are people asking more frequently about? What are people having more difficulty with? How can I make sense of such a huge amount of random text without actually having to go through each and every email that drops in my inbox? So in retrospective, I kind of wish I had thought a little bit more about this before, because it turns out that it's equally hard to do unsupervised learning in a way that is meaningful in the end. And especially if you've been away from Python for a while. So this is to say that the results of the small demo that I'm presenting here might not make a lot of sense in the end. It's more about the process. And I hope that there are people out there that are better at training models than I am. So after doing some groundwork, this is kind of the simplified diagram of the demo that I'm linking down there. So What I did was first train a model with a popular topic modeling algorithm called LDA, using a library called GenSim that has a very good implementation of this algorithm. And after doing that, then this model kind of knows. I trained the model on a year's worth of mailing list data. So after training, this model is able to tell me if I give it a random message from the mailing list, roughly into to which topic it relates. So after having this model trained, I can, oops, is there something wrong with my slides? So I can just pass this model as a dependency to PyFlink along with the libraries inside it, using a user-defined function to support this additional logic that I want to use in my table API, in my Python table API program, to classify my source data. And the logic is pretty simple and straightforward. It's not doing anything crazy. And it's basically just consuming data from a Postgres instance. It's applying this UDF that I just told you about, and then it's syncing the data again to Postgres. And I hooked it up with Superset, which is an open source visualization software. It's really, really cool and easy to use. And just so that we can actually see the output of our pipeline. So originally I had hooked this up with a change data capture connector because this was actually connected to my existing setup where I had an integration that ran from time to time. And then this meant that I could just use Flink to constantly listen to the table. So I just wanted to mention that you can also do this with CDC so that instead of just running your job as like a bounded streaming job, you can do this as like a continuous streaming job, even if you're using Postgres as a source. Okay, so building this pipeline has basically five different steps. And again, just to reinforce, we are using the Python table API. You can also use the Python data stream API if you want, but here I'm just focusing on the table API. So everything you will see from here kind of is exclusive to that. So the first thing we need to do is really define our sources and our sync tables. And there are two ways that you can do this in the Python table API. The recommended way is just to use SQL DDL like I have shown here. So it's the same as if you were creating a table in a regular database, but then you just specify the properties of the connector that is backing the tables. So in our case, all of our data will reside or go to Postgres. So we are using the JDBC connector that is native to the table API and so can also be used in PyFlink. And we'll have our base table where the historical data of the mailing list lives. And we'll also have a dimension table that will be used to look up the description of the topic ID, because our UDF, the way that it's written, it returns an ID. And also I wanted to showcase how you can do a lookup join. So every time we get ID back, we just join with a lookup table so that we can actually put a name to the topic. And then the sync will be the final destination also within Postgres. So next we need to write and register our UDF. And what the UDF basically is doing is cleaning and classifying the messages. So in PyFlink, you can declare a function as a UDF in different ways, depending on whether you want to, for example, override any methods or not. But in the simplest form, declaring a UDF is just about adding the @UDF decorator to your function, specifying the input and output data types it should expect. And in this case, the input of our UDF will be the subject of the messages, and the result will be the topic ID, like I mentioned before. And for all of this to work, we need also our the model that we trained and a dictionary that is also generated during the training that kind of helps in the process of understanding the probabilities distribution of the messages. So one of the most important things for topic modeling to produce meaningful results, and probably why my model doesn't produce very meaningful results, is that you really need to clean and pre-process your data. So that's what the tokenizer is trying to do that you see in there. And I think the last thing that is important to mention about using UDFs in PyFlink is that if you use a generic UDF, it works one row at a time. And if you're trying to do something as heavy as classification, then this has a really, really high overhead for serialization and deserialization between the JVM and the Python VM. So what I'm doing here is specifying my UDF as a pandas UDF, which is vectorized. And what it does is it takes a batch of rows instead as input, and then does the transfer using columnar format, which is much more efficient. And lastly, we just need to build a query that uses the UDF we just created. So I actually just noted after I finished the presentation that I went SQL all the way. You can also use the Python methods from Table API. For me, because of my background, I just go for this kind of analytics work. I think it's just really easy to express this kind of logic with SQL, but you can go your way. So here we are just applying our UDF to our source data. And then we are, like I said before, doing a lookup join with the topics table so that we can get the name of the topic. And now that we have all our steps concluded, with basically what we did in this three steps was create our program file. And what we have to do now is just to actually submit it to the Flink cluster so that the job can actually be run. So if you access the Flink web UI like you see here, and then we just submit it to the cluster with all the dependencies, so like the model and the dictionary, and also method that we're using to client. And then you can see that we get a job running. So success, we have our pipeline finalized. And yeah, once the processing is done, you can just hop onto Superset and you will see there that in the last quarter, basically the most common topics in the Flink user mailing list were sources, deployment, questions about state, the performance of the table API, and scheduling. So like I said, this was a bit of an experiment and not really accurate or very meaningful just because of the way that probably the model was trained. But I hope that this gives you an overview of how you can build a simple analytics pipeline with your custom logic on it. And so in a nutshell, PyFlink, you can use it with Table API and Datastream API. It integrates natively with Pandas, so you can tap on the whole Python ecosystem. And you can also use Python UDFs, even if you are not using the Python Flink APIs. And then, yeah, you can just take advantage of everything that Flink gives you, so like unified streaming and batch execution, all the native connectors, UDFs. Also, you can use it with notebooks. So, yeah. Cool, I think I'm on time, even with the technical problems, which is great. Thank you so much.
Perfect. Thank you, Marta. And next up, we have Ying and Yash from Lyft, and they will be presenting Flink-empowered near real-time streaming data processing at Lyft.
Okay, thanks, Mark. Let me share my screen. Okay, cool. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Apache Flink Meetup at Netflix. Today, we're going to present Flink empowered near real-time streaming data processing at Lyft. My name is Ying. I work on streaming. Today, I'm going to co-present with my colleague Yash, who is also work on streaming. Okay, briefly go over the agenda here. Because of time, we are going to jump straight into the architecture of near real-time data analytics platform. We will then do a deep dive on the platform design, where Yash will take over. Yash will continue on the use cases and applications. In the end, we will summarize our findings and present some of the future directions. So if you guys haven't heard about Lyft, Lyft is a ride-sharing company. Our mission is to improve people's life with world's best transportation. When you open Lyft's app, you can see different modes of transportation from A to B, and you can always select the best transportation mode to get you from to a destination with the most reliable, most efficient way. So moving on, we will jump into the architecture of near real-time data analytics platform, but we would like to first go over the legacy platform architecture and its many shortcomings, which is shown on the slides. So these kind of shortcomings motivates us to develop a new platform. So every day there are thousands of events getting ingested into the system. So what are events? Events are here mainly referred to business events that are mainly used for big data analytics and the BI use cases. So for example, when the ride is picked up, when the ride is dropped off, these are events. Also the location information periodically generated by the mobile apps, these are also type of events. So these events, they all flow into our ingestion system and get first hop get stored on the generic pub sub. So and at Lyft, we mainly use AWS Kinesis as the pub sub and the Kinesis consumer library application. So we call like here is KCR app. It's in charge of consuming events from the Kinesis stream and then process them into S3-based data lake. The processed data was used to be like a raw JSON at the beginning, and then it went through a batch ETL process before they get transformed into a column and a power query data. So the batch ETL is orchestrated by Apache Airflow, which is like an open source workflow engine and run on a daily basis. So the parquet data can then be efficiently queried using query engines such as Presto and Hive and shown to user size through BI tools such as Superset and Mode. So the system has been sustained like Lyft from a startup to a 1,000 people company, but then it obviously has like some issues here. First of all, like persist data cannot be ready for query in near real time. This is because like querying over raw JSON really, really slow and users have to wait for the ETL to finish before they can reliably query the parquet data. And the ETL runs on daily basis. That means like the user experiences data freshness as much as like 24 hours. Secondly, like streaming persistence using KCL, which was like originally written in Python, was not an efficient way. The KCL app was like a relatively low limited performance and ends up with a very large auto-scaling group size, ASG size, to absorb the kind of load that Lyft has. Certainly, the large bloated ASG size also indicates like it could generate many small files because each EC2 instance flushes data very frequently generates new file for every type of events. So the presence of too many small files greatly limits the performance of downstream S3 operations like listing files and those things. Lastly, all the ETLs, like a lot of the ETLs were scheduled on a daily basis. So imagine you have an end-to-end ETL chain. What you often observe is like a multi-step, multi-day latency. So these shortcomings motivate us to develop a new data analytics platform. So the first major change is like we use Flink to replace KCR app for streaming persistence. The Flink can directly consume data from Kinesis stream and then write to parquet directly. So the raw parquet data will go through a number of ETL steps, like ETL processing steps. For example, like for the first tier and second tier, runs some hourly and multi-hourly cadence, again, orchestrated by Airflow. We will come to later like these ETL mainly for compaction and deduplication operations. So the Airflow is also in charge of some kind of Hive metastore operations like schema evolution and partition registration. Whether it's the raw parquet or like a process, ETL process Parquet data, all the Parquet data can be queried through Presto and Hive again, and then display to users through front end like superset and load. So we look at some of the platform design and this highlight. So first of all, probably like most important is like we use Flink for streaming persistence. Flink is, as we all know, like is very efficient stream processing engine. Using Flink for streaming persistence, we are able to reduce the AHG size by a great deal, like 70% or 80%. Flink with streaming file sync can directly unlocks writing persistent data in column of our Parquet format, which supports unlocks interactive query experiences. And certainly, we have like a further down like a ETL process for enhance the performance and data quality. So in other words, users who would like to have near real-time query experiences can directly query the raw Parquet data. But the users who sometimes they want like more performant queries, large scan over large data set. And then if they want like a data set without any duplications, then they can wait for the ETL process to complete and access the compacted and the deduped data set. The system actually has been in production for about a year, over a year now, and it handles like hundreds of billions of events per day at peak. This slide shows the most important service level objectives. First of all, like we can guarantee like a P99 data freshness less than 5 minutes, basically delivering the near real-time query experiences. And then like because using Flink and Kinesis, it's relatively easy to ensure like the pipeline has at least one delivery guarantee. We have like high data completeness delivered and measured. Using the ETL deduplication process, we can also achieve like a high degree of data uniqueness for users who want data quality. So every day, a lot of data scientists and the data engineers, they can run ad hoc interactive queries over the data set on this platform. And the teams have also built real-time dashboards, for example, for monitoring the health of a marketplace. And Yash will present some other use cases and applications like model IO persistence, as well as like G schema call downs. We'll come to that later. So moving on, in the next few slides, we'll go into some deep dive on the platform design specifics. Okay, let's first look at how Flink is embedded into the system. This slide essentially shows the Flink DAG here. We see we use a Flink Kinesis connector as a Kinesis source that constantly pulls events from the Kinesis data stream. Each Kinesis record contains a batch of events, which is then sent to a flat map where it is broken down into individual event for further processing. We will temporarily skip a little bit like the record counter and the aggregator, and because we are going to mention that in the next slide. So the events after getting processing and then like getting partitioned, we will reach into the S3 file sync. As mentioned before, we essentially use the streaming file sync for streaming persistence. What the streaming file sync works is like it aggregates data, batches data in the locally, and then continuously upload batches to the S3 file system, taking advantage of the S3 multi-part upload API. It continuously upload and until the checkpoint time, it will like conclude upload by committing the multi-part upload and then wrote part file, which basically generates a new file. In our Flink job, we configure the checkpoint time to be 3 minutes. So this gives us like a high guarantee of 5 minutes P99 data freshness. Okay, as mentioned before, like a KCR app we used to have like exhibits problem with too many small files. In theory, for the Flink app, it could potentially also generate lots of small files. This is because each sync subtask of the Flink job could potentially generate new file every 3 minutes for every type of event. Because we have so many type of events, so the total number of files could be very large. The way to resolve is using a dynamic partitioning algorithm embedded into Flink. So after the flat map, the records each event will go into record counter, essentially counting the event volume. And then the local event volume will be changed through different sync task subtasks using an aggregation function. The aggregation function derives the event weights for each type of event Here by event weight, I really mean like the event volume percentage in terms of bytes. And then broadcast the weights to downstream. Each event will be tagged by assigned to a subset of sync subtasks. And then for a particular type of event, number subtask is equivalent to the event weight times sync, the total sync parallelism. In other words, if an event is a very low volume, it will also be dispatched to a few sync subtasks instead of like the total, all the sync subtasks. By this means, we are able to reduce the number of files from 20 minutes per day to 50,000 per day. Moving on, like we have like a downstream ETL operations. After raw parquet, we'll go through like first the hourly dedupin compaction process. And then if that's still not sufficient for like a user for higher performance requirements, then we further go into a daily based compaction and dedupe process. It's worth mentioning that the Flink after processing an entire partition worth of data will write the success file to the S3 partition, which will further drive down to the subsequent ETL processing. Okay, I'm going to stop now and switch to my colleague Yash, who will continue on the rest of ETL processing and the rest of content.
Thanks, Ying. Try to present. Are you guys able to see the slides all right?
Yes.
Yes.
Cool, thank you. Yeah, thanks again, Ying. So now that the data has actually landed from Flink into the raw partitions and a success file has been tracked, now let's talk about the various ETL aspects. So the first thing that comes to mind is like the optimizations, right? So despite all the optimizations the Flink application does to reduce the number of small files, in order to be able to guarantee the 5 minutes freshness and also optimal query performance, further compaction may be necessary. By compaction, I mean the process of combining several small parquet files into a larger file. So we have a scheduled ETL process that does periodically compact these files. In addition, since our underlying PubSub framework is at least once delivery system, we may end up with duplicates. So we also need to do deep deduplication in addition to the compaction. And we want to do this at large scale for our customers so that the customers don't have to run deduplication on an ad hoc basis when they run their queries against our data set. So what we have is what we do is we run our compaction process, which is orchestrated via Airflow. In addition to running it every N hours, we also do something called as a look back of MRs, and we'll look at it with more detail in the next slide. So how does deduplication actually work? So the compactor runs every NRs, as mentioned earlier, with a lookback of MRs. And these values actually depend on the nature of the event that's actually being compacted. Sometimes the duplicate data could arrive with varying degrees of lateness. Sometimes the data is delayed by 10 minutes, and sometimes it's delayed by multiple hours. And one thing we found through empirical analysis is that not all events have the same kind of delay characteristics. So based on that, independently, we have configuration that determines what lookback to use and how frequently to run compaction when you're processing a set event. And all events that flow through Lyft have a concept of event ID, which is essentially a UUID, which uniquely identifies each event that flows through the system. And that's exactly the field that we use to deduplicate data over a fixed window. Let's consider an example that's illustrated here in the slide. On the top, we see raw buckets, a raw bucket with 7 hours worth of data. And in the second tier, we see like a compacted bucket with about 4 hours worth of data. When the deduplication or the compaction process runs at hour 5, it is going to do a lookback of 1 along with also processing the 3 new hours of raw data to compact, and thereby ensuring that there's no duplicate across the 4-hour fixed window. Now, let's discuss how the data is laid out in S3 and how partition management is handled. This ETL process will look at every 3 hour interval and create a new bucket, which is called the compacted bucket, which contains the compacted and deduplicated data. While we write the compacted data, we also add something called as an entropy, which is usually the Spark application ID. And we do this so that we don't run into S3 rate limits and also don't and also ensure that our query performance doesn't suffer. In addition, we also write the success file. And the success file actually has two different implications here. So the success file in the raw partition indicates data completeness, while as the success file in the compacted partition actually indicates the availability of high fidelity data for that particular partition. So what we do is once the data actually lands and the compaction is done, the next step is something called as a HMS partition swap. And HMS stands for high meta store, which is essentially a thrift server that's fronting an RDS instance that stores all the partition information for all the tables that are present in Hive. The swap is then performed in an atomic fashion. So for a given partition spec, we remove the pointer from the raw partition and make it point to the compacted partition. And another critical part of our ETL pipeline is something called as a partition registration, which also runs as a dedicated Airflow DAG. And it runs continuously to orchestrate future partitions against Hive Metastore so that the data as it continues to land from a Flink application is almost available to query in near real time instantaneously over Hive or Presto. I would like also maybe mention a quick note on how the downstream DAGs interact with this high fidelity data using Airflow sensor. Since the deduplication and compacted data guarantees are only available after the compactor actually runs, downstream DAGs end up using an Airflow sensor that we wrote, which determines if a success file for a given compacted partition is present, given a DS and HR partition spec, before it continues to do the action that it takes on the data. Since S3 is our persistent state of choice, the sensor is essentially using an S3 Bodo API to check for the presence of success files. In the following couple of slides, let's quickly look over some of the use cases and applications of the near real-time persistence analytics framework. For the first use case, let's talk about something called as G-Schema. And G-Schema is essentially an ETL pipeline that's built on top of GraphQL. For those who are new to GraphQL, what it is is essentially an open source data query and manipulation language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling queries with existing data. This was released by Facebook in 2012. And what G-Schema offers is essentially a low latency, high fidelity data with schema simplicity and fast development experiences. What G-Schema as a service does is essentially ETLs data from online databases into offline SQL databases and data warehouses. It guarantees extremely low latency since the online service lag is usually in the order of under a minute, and also guarantees high fidelity since the data is coming from the online source, and schema simplicity because the schema is defined using GraphQL query language file. And a quick overview of how the architecture looks. This is essentially a noun-based G-Schema architecture. So what exactly is a noun? So a noun is a self-contained business object that's defined in G-Schema. And it invariably maps to a Hive or a Presto table. So here what you see is like a fleet of G-Schema workers that are listening in to a Kinesis fanout stream on a set of pre-configured triggering events. And for each noun, we have an SQS queue which enqueues noun ID from the fanout stream that's emitted from the triggering event. And we also have some Lambda functions that deserializes the batched events and enqueues them into the appropriate noun queue. For example, if you have a passenger ride ID field within the event ride accepted, that's the value that's used to queue it into the rides queue. And then you have the worker also dequeues these noun IDs and executes a pre-configured GraphQL query language to interact with an upstream online service, say rides. And the response from GraphQL is then sent as an analytics event to a sidecar process, which then ships it off to the persistence framework or the near real-time events pipeline into a corresponding Hive table. Another use case is model IO persistence. So to give you some context, within Lyft, we have model execution pipelines running within our ecosystem that persist input, intermediate outputs, and also results of the model execution to S3. The data is used for various scenarios, such as model replay for debugging or model retraining purposes for special events or any kind of ad hoc querying. The persistence workflow has historically been ad hoc, where each model execution pipeline ends up implementing its own S3 tier. We have varying kind of producers that produce this data. So we have, you could have a Beam pipeline or a Python worker, et cetera. And this served as a perfect use case for the existing, for our near real-time persistence framework. By providing a standardized way to persist model execution data, both input and output, into a long-term durable storage by building on top of the existing near-time infrastructure. As a result, the data persisted is being persisted in a standardized way and also can be queried in near real time. So in conclusion, we would like to kind of call out some of the summary and key learnings from this project and also highlight some of the future directions that the project is planning to take. So for experience and lessons, we did quickly realize that Flink plays a very vital role in unlocking the real-time use case of our framework by converting and persisting flat JSON into Parquet using the streaming file sync. This opened up a world of opportunities for building a lot of real-time use cases atop the data that we provide. And we also quickly noticed that the S3 file layout is extremely critical to ensure that we don't get throttled. S3 imposes a put limit of 3,500 operations per second per prefix and also 5,500 get operations per prefix per second. So we had to very clearly demarcate how we structure the files in S3, and we wanted it to be demarcated by event. Another aspect is schema evolution. It turned out to be extremely challenging because we have different data types across Parquet, Protobuf, and Hive, or Presto. Making sure we have a consistent schema which serves as, which is compatible across these three formats, and it's also a lowest common denominator, was critical and challenging and very critical to the key, to the success of the project. And finally, as Ying mentioned, in the legacy architecture, we had to move over a dozen downstream ETL DAGs from a daily partition schema to an hourly partition schema. And that process required that to be extremely meticulous and with our rollout and cutover so that we don't cause any disruption in the pipeline. And finally, for future directions, we would like to continue identifying and onboarding new use cases onto our near real-time persistence framework, besides the ones that we outlined. And we also want to explore options such as Apache Iceberg for storage layer abstractions for larger use cases. We also would like to keep a very close watch on query performance. And one of the ways that we figured we can do that is by running Analyze proactively to gather statistics on compacted partitions and publish them onto Hive Metastore, which will later be used by the Hive cost-based optimizer to use the statistic to generate an optimal query plan. This will dramatically improve the query end user experience. And we're also working on integrating data quality checks that will be regularly evaluated to alert on data issues before they result in a large-scale impact on the business. And finally, we are also want to incorporate an internal reflection service, which essentially serves protobuf descriptors. What protobuf descriptors are essentially is it's a compiled language agnostic representation of schemas that are defined in form of a protofile. And the reflection service essentially serves these protobuf descriptors at runtime through a variety of gRPC APIs, with bindings available in Go, Python, and Java, which also ends up being the majority of languages used within Lyft. And this service fills the schema registry void that we have internally. The ideal deploy uploads these descriptors out to S3 or GitHub, and the reflection service that we just mentioned makes them available through a variety of interfaces. This allows us to kind of obviate the need for a daily package deployment in the data pipeline. Thank you. Would like to call out some of our teammates. It's not been just Ying and me. It's been a group effort, and also we are hiring. So thank you for listening in on the talk.
All right, thanks Ying and Yash. I think we're already at 11:45 now, so we're thinking about jumping right into our third talk. So Next up, we have Sundaram from Netflix presenting backfilling stateful Flink pipelines at a fractional cost using Iceberg.
Let me try to present my screen. Can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, cool. The slides tend to transition, right?
Right, exactly.
Awesome, thank you so much. Mark, thank you so much for the introduction. It was a long title, wasn't it? Anyways, let's jump into the presentation. So to begin with, my name is Sundaram and I work for the Flink platform team at Netflix. I'm sure you might have heard of Netflix at least at one place. So today I'll be talking to you about how we use Iceberg to backfill stateful applications at fractional cost. This work is done in collaboration with my colleague at Netflix, Stephen Wu. Here's an outline of my talk. First, we'll go over the need for backfilling data in Flink applications, and we'll go over why we plan to do it using Iceberg. Then we'll go over the Iceberg source design and some of the challenges related to ordering that we encountered when we implemented the Iceberg source. Finally, we'll look at some numbers from our production deployment. Let's consider a simple Flink application that performs stream joins. This typically involves reading from two or more Kafka sources, joining them in your Flink application, enriching them using either a microservice or using a Cassandra table, and finally producing one or more outputs. We have many such applications in production in Netflix. One of the fundamental challenges while maintaining such a Flink application in production is that a number of these components that you depend on can fail, and you must be ready to handle it. For instance, your sources can fail, and these are the sources from which you read the data. So if they fail, your application is not processing anything. The microservices or the data stores that you depend on for enrichment can fail. Similarly, the output that you send your output to can also fail. As you might have guessed, if any of these components fail, the application will have to stop processing the data and wait for the component to turn healthy. Apart from complexity, the scale at which these applications operate can also introduce failures. At Netflix, we have seen many cases of sudden load queues causing major back pressure in the application, resulting in checkpoint failures for hours, for example. Apart from scale and complexity, you can also have bugs in your applications. And this is something that happens much more common than we think it would. Apart from bugs, you might also have made assumptions that may not hold true in your application. And when these happen, the output that you produce may not be valid and you might have to correct this output. So we know that the application can fail a lot or can produce wrong output. So what is its impact on the business? If the application fails to come back up or if you are unable to correct the bug in a meaningful amount of time, and if the sources that you depend on have shorter retention than this, then there will be a significant loss of data. If the application was critical to the business, then this loss of data can essentially mean loss of millions of dollars of value. For instance, pipelines related to payments tend to have tend to be in the critical path, and any data loss can have like huge loss to the business. Of course, if the output of the pipeline was critical, then you are thinking, okay, I've already figured out a way to fix that. I'm going to have a separate batch pipeline, like a Lambda architecture, so that you can backfill this lost data. But if you think about it, it's not always going to be easy, as you will have to maintain two separate code paths, one for your streaming pipeline using Flink, and the other for your batch pipeline using either Flink or Spark, for example. Apart from that, you also have to coordinate backfills with your downstream consumers, and all of this can get very complex pretty easily. So how do you go about avoiding data loss in case of continuous failures? The easiest way is to just increase the retention on the stream from a few hours to however long you think you would need to keep you covered. Just to make sure everyone understand what this means and how it helps, let's take this example. Let's say you had an issue at offset 105, and essentially you figured out that you lost some data, or you've made some mistakes, all you need to do is you essentially need to go back to the oldest offset, start replaying the data from that offset. So this solution has some very nice properties, right? One is that it has very low engineering cost. All you need to do is essentially change some configurations, and boom, you have something that works, right? To avoid data loss. The other nice property about this solution is that it can work for all your stream processing engines. Let's say you have multiple stream processing engines, and the solution can pretty much work for all of them, right? Because this is basically changing how you read the data. But this approach also has one big disadvantage, which is that it's very expensive. To understand this better, let's try to come up with the cost model for increasing the retention from 4 hours all the way to 30 days for data on Kafka. Let's assume you store a petabyte of data for 4 hours. And this is typical in really large organizations where billions of events are produced every second, right? Such as Google, Facebook, and Netflix. So this is very common. So we're not hyping this up. So let's say we take in we store all these events on EBS disk volumes. And these tend to have cost of $1,000 per terabyte every year. So if you factor in all this cost and you also factor in the replicas that you need, this essentially amounts to around $1 million a year. This is not too bad for large companies. Now, let's say we extrapolate this and we want to instead store 1 day of data, right? So essentially what this would mean is that if failures don't last for more than a day, you should be fine. You should not have any data loss. So if you just extrapolate this cost, what this amounts to is that you essentially get $6 million of cost every year. Again, you might think that's not too bad. Now let's see what it looks like for 30 days. For 30 days, essentially you have to store now 180 petabytes of data, right? And the cost quickly bubbles up to $180 million. And this is a lot of money, and it might be a very hard sell to your managers. So what we realize is that even though the increasing stream retention is a fairly easy approach and has some nice properties, it is very expensive and may not really work if we really want to increase the retention to a large time. So now you might wonder, wouldn't a cloud store be better for storing something like this? Right, because some of the properties about this data, right, which is that this data is going to be infrequently accessed. It's not going to be it doesn't require really low latencies. It doesn't require really high IOPS, for example. So you might wonder, okay, what if I store this data on S3 or another cloud store, a cloud object store? Wouldn't that be better? And let's try to try to find the cost model for that. So another advantage of storing this in a cloud object store is that you can actually use really good file formats like Parquet, for example, and that gives you a lot of compression, right? Typically at Netflix, we see Parquet giving us around 6x compression compared to using regular disk. And we also do not have to store, we also do not have to replicate this data across regions because S3 or other cloud object stores already provide you those guarantees. So if you factor in both these factors, what this amounts to is that instead of storing 180 petabytes of data, you only now have to store 15 petabytes of data. And if you also factor in the S3 cost taken from the S3 website, you essentially now only have to deal with $4 million every year rather than $180 million. Now that's a 40x improvement. It's going to be a much easier sell to your managers. Obviously, just because you store data in S3 doesn't mean you can get rid of all the Kafka data. You also have to retain some of the Kafka data for your application. So let's also factor that in. So what that essentially means is that you are storing historical data on S3, you're storing the latest data that your Flink applications are more or less going to use mostly on Kafka. This all amounts to around $5 million of value, essentially. So this strategy seems to be a much better option than just purely extending Kafka's retention. Now, Based on this, we can basically arrive at three separate goals that need to be satisfied by any backfilling solution that we want to have. One of the nice properties that we liked about extending Steam's retention was that it was applicable to all Flink applications, not just a specific application. So this must be something that our backfilling solution should strive for. Another nice property is that with increasing the stream retention, we didn't have to make any code changes because all we had to do was change the configuration, and we pretty much got the backfilling capability free of cost at that point. So that is also another nice property to have. And finally, it must scale to support backfilling months of data, and it must be like cheap in doing that. This was the one property that our previous solution did not have. So the question is, can we make sure that all these goals can be addressed with our backfilling solution? And this is precisely what backfilling using Iceberg provides, right? Let me try to explain that using in the next set of slides. So at Netflix, most of our stream data on Kafka by default ends up on S3 through Iceberg Data Lake. To understand what Iceberg is actually a table format. You can think of it as an abstraction on top of your cloud object stores, providing some stronger guarantees than your cloud object stores, as well as addressing some of the underlying problems with these stores. For example, all changes to Iceberg tables are atomic in nature, and it basically provides serializable isolation. Right. Similarly, when reading reading table data from S3, Iceberg allows filtering files based on column level statistics. All these advantages can come in very handy when you want to backfill large volumes of data, because it will allow you to skip a whole set of files that you need to read otherwise if you were just using S3 directly. So we know that most of this data is going to be on Iceberg. The question is, how can we use this data for backfilling, right? And the solution to this is very simple, right? We basically want to have a dual source, the Kafka source for the live data, the Iceberg source for the historical data for backfilling needs. So all this essentially means is that we just have to provide a backfill connector that looks and feels like the Kafka connector to our Flink applications, so that they can get this backfill capability in their applications with all the goals that we had. So to understand the semantics, what this implies is that when you need to read data from your Flink application, recent data from the Flink application, you'll essentially be reading from Kafka. When you need to read historical data from in your Flink application, you're going to be reading that from Iceberg. And the goal would be to do this as transparently as possible. So you might all want, okay, this is all sounding hunky dory. What's the catch in this? So there's one interesting challenge that we have to think about when it comes to the Iceberg source. One of the goals that we had for the backfilling solution was that we wanted no code changes to be made to the business logic during backfill, right? So in other words, the backfilling source more or less has to behave like a streaming source, because we still do not have proper unified batch streaming API in Flink. So essentially what this means is that whatever assumptions the Flink application has made about your streaming source, those assumptions will have to be held true when it comes to the backfilling source. So for example, things like periodic checkpointing has to be supported. If your Flink application was using event time semantics to emit watermarks, those will have to be supported and so on. So in other words, not only do you have to read all the events from your Iceberg tables, when it comes to backfill, you also have to ensure that they are emitted in the same order as Kafka. Otherwise, the application may not behave correctly. So to understand what this means, let's try to take a quick look into what guarantees Kafka provides when it comes to ordering of data. So Kafka provides strict ordering of messages within a partition. Across partitions, it doesn't provide any ordering. So for example, in this case, let's say your stream was reading, your application was reading fifth offset from partition one, second offset from partition two, and eighth offset from partition three. It will continue to read in a linear fashion within these partitions, but across partitions, there is no ordering guarantees. So the question here is that do all Flink applications really rely on these ordering guarantees? And if so, like what do we do about this from the Iceberg source? So when we did research on this, what we figured out was that we had three classes of Flink applications at Netflix, applications that did not expect any ordering guarantees. So you can think of all these simple integers, mappers, applications that filter data, like these kind of applications did not make any assumptions about the ordering. So for these applications, the backfilling source, all it has to provide is it has to ensure that all the data that you missed will be read during backfilling. So that is the only guarantee that you need to provide. And then we had another class of applications which basically expected some rough ordering. So these were typically applications that were joining streams and they were using like event time semantics. And these applications made some assumptions around how the data was ordered, when it was being read in the application. So for these applications, you have to provide some rough ordering guarantees. I'll go deep into what rough ordering means in the next set of slides. And then there was another class of applications which actually depended on Kafka ordering guarantees. So these applications made assumptions around the total ordering of messages within a partition, and they were basically making use of that in their application. So typically, CDC use cases tended to have these assumptions. So like I mentioned, no ordering and total ordering seems fairly simple. No ordering essentially means you don't provide any guarantees on the data. Ordering data, all you need to do is make sure that all of the data is being read. Total ordering essentially means Kafka ordering. So what does rough ordering mean for stateful apps? So to understand this, let's quickly dive a little deep into how the data is actually stored on Iceberg tables so that we can see what does rough ordering mean from that perspective. So every change to an Iceberg table results in a new immutable snapshot. And the snapshot itself is partitioned by date, hour, and so on. And at the leaf level, you basically have all these data files, which is basically the events stored in a file format like Parquet, for example. Now, so for example, for these 4 hours for this given date, we have all these 12 different data files which are being stored in Iceberg stream tables. Now let's imagine that we need to backfill these 4 hours of data, right? Basically, we have to essentially what this means is that from the Flink application, we have to pipe in these 12 data files into the application. So these are the 12 data files that need to be read. By rough ordering, what we mean is that we basically read these events such that there is a misalignment limited by certain threshold. For example, let's say our threshold is set to 1 hour. What this means is that we can read data from the first hour, but till all these data files are read, we cannot read the next set of data files. So we cannot read D3 and D4 till D0 to D1 is complete, right? Similarly, you cannot read files from hour 3 till you're done with the files from hour 2 and so on. So this essentially guarantees some ordering of events to the application, not the Kafka ordering, but most applications we figure out are good with this. So in reality, it's not as simple as this because you can have really short misalignment thresholds. For example, some of the applications that we operate have misalignment thresholds set to 15 minutes, for example, because those are the assumptions that they've made in their business logic about the ordering of events. And the other thing is that the other problem is that it's not like this is going to be static windows. Instead, it's moving windows. So that also introduces certain challenges. So far we've seen why we need to backfill data. We've also seen how we can backfill data using Iceberg. We've seen some of the ordering challenges that the Iceberg source poses. And now let's look into some numbers from a production deployment. So with respect to evaluating the Iceberg source, there were two questions that we wanted to answer. One was, does rough ordering actually produce the correct output for real world applications? Because the application doesn't know anything about that the data is being read from Iceberg, and it doesn't know anything that, okay, the Iceberg source does not provide me the same guarantees as Kafka, for example. So the question is, can rough ordering actually work for real world applications? And the second question that we wanted to answer was, what is the performance cost of rough ordering? So let's take a look into both these questions quickly. So to check for rough order incorrectness, what we did was we took a really large production job at Netflix that was doing streaming joins. And this made certain assumptions about the event time semantics, and it was using watermarks to like trigger data aggregation and so on. So what we figured out was when we set the miscellaneous threshold to a reasonably high number, even for a reasonably high number, the output that was produced by the backfill application pretty much matched 100% with the production application. So this in a way validated that the backfill source actually was correct, and it can be used for like no real applications. Like I mentioned, the other thing that we wanted to see was like what is the overhead that rough ordering introduces. So true to this, what we did was we basically took a stream that that roughly had like 100 megabytes per second ingestion rate, and we basically like you know try to backfill like different volumes of this data. So for example, we ran a backfill for 2 hours, right? 4 hours and so on. So the x-axis is the amount of data that was backfilled. And the y-axis basically represents the relative overhead, relative throughput performance against the baseline. The baseline was basically the no ordering case. Because if you did not have any ordering constraints, you can pretty much read all this data with as much parallelism as you want, right? So all of this benchmarks were actually run on a 40-node cluster with 8 CPUs, 27 gigs of memory, and so on. So what we observe is that when you set the miscellaneous threshold to something like 15 minutes, the overhead that it introduces actually is reasonably small, right? So even with as small a miscellaneous threshold as 15 minutes, the overhead that it introduces is only like less than 25%, for example, right? For most amount of data, right? It starts flatlining at some point of time. But if you set it to a really low number, such as 5 minutes, for example, right? That's when you start seeing really high overheads, because this essentially means you cannot exploit all the parallelism with your task managers as you would have liked, because you're constantly hitting synchronization points, and till those synchronization points are hit, like you cannot like basically emit more events. But this is like the worst case scenario. Like we don't typically expect to operate in this zone. We typically expect to operate in the 15 minute plus zone. So we are okay with respect to the performance of rough ordering in those cases. To summarize, Iceberg provides capabilities to backfill stateful Flink applications efficiently at fractional cost. We've seen that there are some ordering challenges that the Iceberg source poses, and how different ordering guarantees can be provided by the Iceberg source. We've also evaluated the Iceberg source for both correctness and performance in production deployments. In the future, we plan to work with the community to open source the Iceberg connector that we have. We plan to provide a strict Kafka ordering to applications that need it. We don't today offer that. We only offer no ordering and rough ordering guarantees. We also plan to have a continuously streaming Iceberg source for applications that do not require subsequent latency, so that backfilling and bootstrapping data like you know comes free of cost for these applications. And finally, we plan to work with the open source community to have a hybrid streaming batch source, so that the source can automatically figure out whether it needs to read from Kafka or Iceberg, depending on like where the data is found. Thank you so much.
All right, thanks, Sundaram. So now we're gonna break out into multiple rooms using Zoom's breakout rooms. So to join a breakout room, you'll have a breakout room button at the bottom, and you just need to click that and hover over the room name to reveal the join button. And in 20 minutes or so, we'll meet back here to conclude the meetup.